Okay, well, thanks a million to Dave and to Colin and Kathy and to Rose, and we had an amazing session. And I think we won't go into questions now. We have a cup of tea, and we have one very important final speaker, short session with somebody who's in the direct provision system. So that's really, I suppose, better Robert.
Thank you to all the organizers of this event, and I also want to thank you all for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to speak this evening. My name is Patricia Murambinda, and I live in Portlaoise. I'm a Zimbabwean nationality. I've been in Ireland for 7 years. This is my 8th year in the direct provision, and I'm still waiting for my answer. When I first arrived in Ireland, I was accommodated in the voucher scheme for just a month. That was 2009 September. After that, I was transferred to Portlaoise, so I've been in Portlaoise ever since. I lived in the Montague Hotel. I will tell you about the experiences that I've gone through, the positive ones and the negative ones. My positive experience is that I've managed to integrate in Portlaoise through the community with my church and the priests and the sisters in Portlaoise. I went to various pilgrimages with them, which was fantastic. I learned to live with the community, and they do really like me. I do voluntary work with my church. At the moment, I'm doing voluntary work Tuesdays and Fridays. I went to Portlaoise College, that was 2014 to 2015. I did information technology with 10 subjects. Can you imagine at my age? Now I'm 54 years. But I don't look 54 at all. I passed those subjects, but I can't go to a third level education because the government doesn't allow me to do so. I would love to, but the government doesn't want to. I volunteered for various organizations in Ireland. I started in Dublin, I came to Portlaoise, I continued. Sometimes I could travel from Portlaoise to Dublin just to go and volunteer. I think some of you, they see me on television being interviewed by RT in one. And I've spoken really about direct provision. I even went to the Dáil in 2013 for the Bill of Information. We wanted to talk about the direct provision, how the children are treated in the direct provision. Why can't they give them the same treatment as Irish children? You know, in the direct provision, children are not allowed to go, like, maybe for swimming. I've never seen a child going for swimming in the direct provision because our bus times are scheduled. If the bus ends at 4 or at 4:15, you must be there at 4:15 in the direct provision. We fought hard, but we are not winning. I know someday we will win. Because they always say it's a light at the end of the tunnel. It's not going to live like this. Even if Trump is in power now, we are still going to fight. No matter what, we will not stand back. I traveled to Dublin to do some other courses as well. You know, free courses, those were in modules. Like maybe I take psychology, I did one module. And I was traveling for 19 euro 10 cents every week, which was twice a week. It was tough. It was really, really tough, you know, getting up from Portlaoise, going to Dublin and coming back. But with resilience, I did it. I managed. I got it. I got what I wanted. With the support again in the community, I know I pulled through. And I really wanted to show that I'm a winner, not a loser. I don't have fear of anything anymore because my faith stays in me. I believe that God will do something for me one day and do something for everyone in the direct provision. I wish one day they just close those direct provisions because, you know, in the direct provision, you
you are like in an open prison. You don't know when exactly you are going to come out. There are some in the direct provision, believe me or not, there are some in the direct provision who are 9, 10, 11, 12 years. But we still go on. Some, you know, they have been affected because they can't go out there. They are really afraid. They have got this mental illness with them and they are on tablets. You know, you came from home, you were not ill. When you are in the island, you get sick. And when your parents or your sister or your brother calls you and you don't want even to talk to them because you are afraid, oh, I'm not feeling well, to tell them that story that I'm not feeling well. Yet you are in a kind whereby you want to feel protected, but you are not protected at all. These are some of the kinds that we want to fight, the kinds of things that we want to fight. You know, the most vulnerable people in the direct provision are the children, because they know nothing. There are children who have been born in the direct provision. I've seen them being born, you know, from 1 week, 2 weeks, months, years, and even attending school. Some are already in school, and I look at them and I say, wow, this is not right. This is not right at all. This is some sort of racism. This is some sort of punishment. There is an organization actually called RIA. You know, when they say RIA, when in the direct provision, when they say RIA is coming to meet the people in the direct provision, and they, you know, they want to meet on one basis, people are even afraid to go and see them. Because they always say, maybe, you know, if you tell your story, you are targeted. That fear in people, that fear that they instilled in people, people can't even open up. They are afraid, really, really afraid. It's something that is actually, you know, depressing them. And the other thing, when, you know, we go for our interviews in Dublin, sometimes we go early in the morning, we are wanted there by 9 o'clock. We leave, we take a bus very early in the morning, we don't eat anything. We are only given money for bus fare. Bus fare. I have one who was an asylum seeker can vouch for me. I think he's here like he can pull it. You are only given money for bus fare. You are not even given money, okay, when you get to Dublin, I know your interview will take 4 hours. You know, that torment itself, where it puts you, it's really, really painful, because when you come out of that interview, you'll be thinking, did I go well with this interview? Did I did my best? What are they going to give me? What answer are they going to give me? Is it a positive answer or a negative answer? To tell you my story, I've been to 3 interviews. The first interview that I went, they told me that the person who interviewed me just resigned and he didn't write my report. I was like, what? Are you tormenting me? Or you are abusing me? I wrote the letter to the Department of Justice. It's like, okay, my lawyer need to call me and say, Patricia, take it. Go to that subsidiary interview. See what happens. I went to that interview again. They couldn't find my papers fine enough. Then last year, August, I went for another interview. What a torment. Really, what a torment. Sometimes when you get there, you want to fight back, but something holds you back. You know, with faith, I always stand strong in the Lord to tell the Lord that, you know what, my Lord, I'm walking with you. You are the light in my feet. Because there's no man who can be stronger than you. When I got to that interview, I was interviewed. They told me that in 3 weeks' time, I'll be getting my results. Up to today, as I'm standing here, I haven't heard from them. Nothing at all. There are people who went after me, they've already replied them with negative answers. So I'm praying to the Lord each and every day that, Lord, just open the doors for me. Because I don't want to sit, I want to do something. I don't want, even when I get my papers, I'm not going to sit around. I have two hands, I'm still strong, I'm still young. Even if I feel the age is, you know, it's taking me down, but I know that I'm able to stand up and do something for myself. Going back to the children part of it, the children in the direct provision are not allowed, you know, they go to school, some of them, they are not allowed to bring friends to sleep over in the direct provision. You know, that shows some sense of hate. Why do you hate our children? Why do you, you know, put aside our children? When they get our, when you get our papers, those children are supposed to, you know, to integrate with the community. Are they going to be able to integrate with the community? Yet we have been treating them so badly when they were in internal provision. I remember a certain lady telling me a story that when she got her papers, you know, in the direct provision, when maybe when you eat, sometimes you go and wash your plate in the bathroom. It sounds queer. Then when she got her papers, the daughter, when she finished eating, she took the plate and she straight away went to the bathroom and said, "Going to the kitchen," because she's not used to the kitchen anymore. We can't cook for ourselves. If someone is sick in the direct provision, let me tell you a story. If someone is sick, I'm looking for someone who is sick, even Mom, Mary, May, if you can tell you. I asked the manager if I can cook for her. And they told me that once I finish cooking, I should hide my pots because Ria doesn't want us to cook in the kitchen, in our rooms.